every single thing that you've gone through equips you to be able to do what you were born to do.
Welcome back to the Find Your Purpose Now podcast. I want to talk to you today about how we have this ability in us to create. And I think we don't really understand. I'm not sure that we're truly capable of understanding the immense capacity of that potential for creating. We're made in the image of God. This is what the Bible says, and I'm just going to go ahead and believe it, that we're made in the image of God. God is the creator of the universe. So that means that we've been endowed with a certain amount of creativity. And anything that we're endowed with, any gifts, any talents, any abilities, we have them because we're meant to use them. We've been given dominion over every living thing. I'm terrible at quoting chapter and verse of the Bible, but it's in Genesis. Now that we have keyword search for the Bible, go to Bible Gateway, Bible Hub, go to the Bible app, wherever you want to go, and look it up. We've been given dominion. And I mean, I could go on and on about that, but I won't. But we have dominion on this planet. We're the top of the food chain. We're the only species that has that ability to create. We've been given authority over the power of the enemy. There is an ancient enemy. Jesus said, we have an enemy who came to kill, steal, and destroy. And Jesus came that we might have life and have it more abundantly. So I think that means, and that's that one I do know, that's John 10:10. I think that means that being a Christian is not just about the next life, although the next life is eternity. It probably matters a lot more than this little drop in the bucket amount of time that we're in this life. But while we are here, we have this amazing authority over evil. We have dominion over every living thing. We have this creativity inside of us, which is different for every one of us. It doesn't mean that every single one of us is supposed to be an amazing painter or an amazing musician or whatever it is. There are all different types of creativity. You might be somebody who's really good at resolving conflict with people. You might be the one who kind of keeps the family going when this one's not talking to this one and this one's hurt about something that somebody else said. You may be the one who comes up with some kind of a creative solution that brings everybody back together. Whatever your creativity is, you're meant to use it. So think about this. We're meant to create products and services, businesses, community service organizations. We're meant to create families. And that doesn't just mean blood. That can mean collecting people who you want to do life with. We're meant to create neighborhoods, not just places where people go inside their door and close the door and lock it and never interact with anybody outside of their door. And let me tell you, I'm an off the chart introvert. So that's my natural inclination. But life is so much richer when we reach out and we have a hand in turning our place that we live into a neighborhood. Otherwise, it's just houses or apartments or whatever it is on the block, on the street, buildings on a street. A few years back, I moved into a new neighborhood and I didn't know anybody. And I took a little package of, I think it was homemade fudge or something like that. It was just a little thing with, you know, wrapped in cellophane with a bow and a little note. And I took it to every one of my neighbors. And, you know, it didn't happen overnight, but eventually it happened. And I'm not saying it had anything to do with me. It's just that, like, somebody has to start the conversation. So now, it's a real neighborhood, and we celebrate each other. We celebrate birthdays. We celebrate good times. We're together in hard times, and life is so much better when we're in a neighborhood and we know our neighbors. We can create our neighborhood and set the tone for the neighborhood. We can do that with communities. We can expand out and from our neighborhood do good things out into the community. And every single time that we create something good, we're modeling for everybody around us how it's done. It's a beautiful thing. Unfortunately, too often, we as individuals, we conform to the neighborhood. If everybody drives into their garage and the garage door goes down and you never see them again, you don't want to talk? I don't want to talk. And we're like that. We conform at work. If people are gossiping in the lunchroom or telling dirty jokes or just inappropriate stuff, racial kind of things or whatever, putting somebody else down, we can turn away and walk away. We don't have to engage in that. And if that's the best we can do, by all means do that. Don't engage in what other people do that you know is inappropriate. But I think we can do better. We can stand up and say, oh, no, we don't want to hear that. We can change the subject. We can start talking about something else. We can be the one who sets the tone in our home, in our workplace, in our neighborhood, in our community. We can, in other words, create the culture. And I think that's what Christians are meant to do. We live in, I've heard this said, I don't like it, but I think it's probably true, a post-Christian world. I heard something recently that over 1 million people a year fall away from the Christian faith. I don't know if that's just in the United States or worldwide, and I don't know if those numbers are true. And how do we even know what's in a person's heart? But my point is, I heard that statistic and I thought, man, that's so sad to fall away from your faith, to choose that I'm just not going to really believe that anymore. Why? Why do people fall away from their faith? I think it has an awful lot to do with our culture because our culture seeps into our lives. If we engage in, inappropriate jokes in the lunchroom or whatever, oh, it's not that big of a deal. Don't be a prude. Don't be an idiot. And you go ahead and engage. And it's a little bit of this, and it's a little bit of watching something inappropriate online or on the TV or whatever. And it's a little bit of, listening to lyrics and songs that, really aren't something that we want to be putting into our head, whatever it is. A little bit, a little bit, a little bit, a little bit. And we figure, it's not that big of a deal. And the next thing you know, you wake up and it's 5 years later and you're not the person you used to be. Maybe you're drinking. Maybe you're smoking or using gummies to fall asleep at night or, whatever it is. Maybe you're going to listening to music and going to movies that you wouldn't have engaged in before. What does that mean? It means that the culture got into you. And what's supposed to happen, if you think of a ship, we're like these ships on the water. We're on the water, we're surrounded by the water, but we can't let the water into us. Because if we do that, we sink. We become part of it. We're supposed to set the culture. We're supposed to cast the vision for what's possible. We're supposed to rise above. And when we do that, when we go ahead and live our faith in front of everybody else, it's attractive. When we live our life and share the stuff that we go through and share that we're praying about it and we're trusting God, and then people watch our lives and they see answered prayer, and they see us doing good things, helping other people, maintaining peace and joy through it all. Because you know what? There are those times when, yeah, the prayers don't get answered. But when we have our faith firmly within us, we don't throw in the towel. We don't think that our plan was so much better than God's plan, and He didn't answer my prayer just exactly the way I wanted it and the timing I wanted it. So I'm done. I'm out. We don't do that. But when people see us, that we remain peaceful and calm, and yeah, we don't like it, and we might cry, but we still trust God, that is attractive. See, we don't have to beat people over the head with Bibles. We don't have to make visiting our church mandatory for a continued friendship. We don't have to try to impose our faith on anyone, but we do have to be willing to share the reason for the hope that we have. And we do have to live with faith in front of others and be good to others. Jesus said, wherever it is in the Bible, I don't know. But I think it was one of the last recorded prayers. I think it's in John. That He wanted us to be known by our love, the way we love other people. That changes the culture. You could imagine people who don't believe, maybe people who have been hurt by Christians, getting invited to the church. Oh yeah, that's what I really want to do. I'm going to go over there and, you know, be bored and fall asleep and whatever their idea of it is. But imagine inviting somebody to come and join you in taking sweaters and coats and blankets to people who are homeless in the winter. You know, a lot of people can get behind that. In us doing those kinds of things, we're just showing people how to love. And we know that God is love. When you give people opportunities, when you create opportunities and give people opportunities to show their love, to exercise their creativity, it's attractive. It attracts people to our faith. And I think that's what we're meant to do. I know that the Bible tells us that we're all supposed to preach the good news, preach the gospel. But I love what St. Francis of Assisi said when he said, preach the gospel always. If necessary, use words. So you can create relationships with your neighbors, with your coworkers, with people in your community who have shared interests. My goodness, there's some kind of a group for everybody now. If you're into crafting, if you're into fishing, if you're whatever you're into, there's a group. If you find your people and you create some opportunity for people to do good in the community, to help people who are vulnerable, to help the most vulnerable of us, it's a beautiful thing. Many of us search our whole lives looking for God's purpose for our life and never find it. And it's really sad because I've talked a lot about the different clues and the things that we can do to find our purpose. One of the easiest ways is to figure out our creativity and then put it to work. And that will attract your people to you. Now, when you start to do these kinds of things, everything might be great. It might fall into place. It might be wonderful. But I want to just kind of warn you, it may not. You might meet with some kind of resistance because, you know, we have that ancient enemy who does not want you to live your purpose. That's a threat to the enemy and to the evil in the world. Because your purpose involves doing good. Your purpose involves giving other people dignity. It can be as simple as making eye contact with somebody, inviting them, including them, making them feel important. The enemy doesn't want that. So, you know, as soon as that ancient enemy sees that you're moving forward and using this creativity that's been given to you and attempting to do good in the world, you know, you might find some obstruction. You might hear whispering in your ear of, you're not enough. Who do you think you are? What do you think you're doing? You can't do this. You can't pull that off. Nobody's going to, you know, participate with you. Everybody thinks you're a loser, whatever it is. Don't listen to that stuff. If you will persevere and you will continue to move forward, you will succeed. You can't lose at doing God's plan for your life. It's what you were born for. There's no promise that it's going to be all, you know, rainbows and stardust. But you push through and you keep going and it will work out. Because when the enemy sees that he can't deter you, he can't diminish the fulfillment of God's perfect purpose for your life. He can't distract you. He'll give up and move on. One more thing that I want to talk to you about today is that it's how our work plays into this. Many of us think that our work is this necessary thing that we have to do. It's drudgery. We drag ourselves to it. We don't love it. And then our purpose is something to be found outside of work, something that we do on the side or something that, you know, we'll do when we retire or after, you know, we raise our kids or whatever it is. Our work, whatever it is, should be the thing that we love to do and find service in. It's our service to the world. It's our contribution. It involves the meaning of our life. And you might be rolling your eyes right now, so much so that, you know, you're going to need surgery to pull your eyes back down where they go. Just think about it for a minute. Wherever you are and whatever you're doing, there's a reason for it. Maybe it's not forever. Maybe it's a temporary life assignment and you're there for a reason and you will have another opportunity open up for you when you're supposed to move on to the next assignment. But while you're there, do your best to find meaning. Maybe it's a relationship with a coworker. Maybe it's a relationship with a client. Maybe a relationship with a vendor. Whatever other human beings are involved with that work, maybe it's about them. Maybe it's not so much the work. Maybe it is whatever you're doing for work that's a contribution to people. I don't know. Every situation is different. But I really want to encourage you to not think of your work as drudgery. Hang in there. Do your best to find meaning in it. And pray. Pray for God to just open up a door to whatever is part of your life assignment and purpose, or to show you the assignment right where you are right now. We need to have a shift, I think, in our thinking from our work being about us. And that maybe our work is the source of potential fame or fortune, or simply paying the bills, whatever it is. Think about how your current work can benefit others. Maybe it's the customers that are served. Maybe it's your coworkers. I don't know, whatever your situation is, but think about what you do and how it can benefit others. The fact that our good work may bring us attention and financial reward is great. But that's secondary. It's far more likely to happen when our focus and our goal and our striving is all about helping others, showing our love to others in our own way, using our creativity and our unique personalities, our intelligences, all those other things that I've talked about before. If you haven't heard those things, please go back and listen to other episodes of this podcast. Because you're important. You matter. What you do matters greatly. You have the opportunity to bring the light of the world with you into dark places. You can turn a street of buildings into a neighborhood of people who really care about one another. You have the opportunity to reach out into your community and pull people together to help others. I mean, as I'm recording this, it's cold outside. Now, if you're listening to this in the middle of July, now I just dated it, but the same is true no matter what season you're in. But if you think about, okay, it's cold outside, there are homeless people probably within a 30-minute drive of wherever you are, wherever you're listening to this, you could put a post on Facebook and say, hey, I'm going to collect sweaters, coats, and blankets. If you can deliver them to this address, or, you know, on this day at this time, I'll meet you in the grocery store parking lot or whatever, and I'll take whatever you want to donate. You'll be surprised how many people will show up when you give them an opportunity to help. You don't have to wait for somebody at City Hall to come up with something, or the local community center, although you can go down to the community center and say, hey, I'm here to serve. What can we do together? You can do that. You don't have to do it on your own. You can find different groups in the area that are already doing something and join into somebody who's, you know, already got some project going. But let's do those things. Let's just not live our lives for us. It's not all about us. Your work is not all about you. Everything you do is not all about you. Our purpose, when fulfilled, makes us feel good. It does something good for somebody else. I think in a lot of cases, at least for me, I know that the times that I've helped other people, I think I've been helped more than they have. It does more for my heart and my soul. And I'm telling you, when you do this, you feel better. You really can't be depressed, sad, anxious while you're engaged, actively engaged in helping someone who needs help. I encourage you to try it. And I want to hear about what you try. I want to hear about what happens. And so go ahead and put comments here in this video, or you can go to my website, Rhonda, rhonda.org, and send me a message. I really would love to hear about it. If you're not sure what to do, I want you to go to loveisaction.com, loveisaction.com, and you can get some ideas. There are all kinds of partners and programs and resources that are there to help you or inspire you with ideas that you can do with almost, I mean, some of them, no resources. So I want you to know this one thing can be life-changing. It really can. You never know when somebody that you reach out to help or somebody that you include in a project to help others is going to be your new best friend, somebody who enriches your life in ways that you never thought possible. That's been my story. I've met so many beautiful souls. When I shifted from my work being about me and, I mean, I thought I was doing good things and I think we did a lot of good work, but I cared an awful lot about proving myself, proving that I was worthwhile and valuable, and I had to be doing something good in order to be valuable and worthwhile. So I measured my worth and value by my success in business. I don't have to do that anymore. And that's what I want for you, because as long as we're measuring our worth and value by how popular we are, or how much money we have, or how prestigious of a job we have, or how successful our company is, or any of those kinds of external things, then as successful, as good as we might feel about all that, the train can go down here and we can feel awful. When things don't work out, that feeling of worth is gone. But if you get your worth and value inside of you, from who you are, and the good that you have in you that you allow out through your creativity and your expression of love, when you put your love into action to help other people, you just feel really good about yourself. And that can't be taken away from you. That's not gonna disappear when you lose an account or when the next mega virus shuts down the company you work for or whatever happens. You won't lose that because it's not on the outside, it's on the inside. So that's it for today. Thank you for being here. I hope that you'll share this with whoever you think that can benefit. And subscribe and come back next week. I'll see you soon. The things that you've been through have changed the way you see the world. They've qualified you to do what you were born to do and perfectly matched to do. Is there anything more important than finding and living the purpose for which you were born? I don't think so. I think that's the point.